It isn't in the morning, isn't at night. It's a talk show for the afternoon when everything's alright. It's a little bit of knowledge and a lot of noise. It's two tall boys.
Tall Boys is not filmed in front of a live studio audience. There's no audience whatsoever.
Hi. Welcome. Whoa. Hello. That's right. It's that time again of the week.
Welcome to another episode of Tall Boys.
That's right.
Hi, I'm John Farnsworth.
And I'm Devin Ritchie.
And we are coming to you from Brooklyn.
That's right.
It was a snowy one this week.
Boy, so yeah, we had a little hiccup, a little day late. We couldn't really fight through the blizz to film.
So we're coming to you out on Wednesday.
Wow, crazy. I know that's hard for all of our fans who really keep up. Every
Tall
single
Boy
week.
Tuesdays.
Yeah, absolutely.
Tall Boy Tuesdays, you know, too.
We'll get back to the regular schedule.
But
as usual, we are here with we got some collective arts brewing.
I'm really excited about this one.
This is delicious. It's a perfect winter beer.
It's snowing outside right now. And
it's
a porter. I'm gonna crack this.
Yeah, this is a chocolate and coconut porter. Yeah, Casey cracked that too. Mm.
Ooh.
Oh yes. That's
chocolate
beautiful.
And coconut porter. Mm. It's called Stranger Than Fiction. It's
no,
great.
Just Stranger Than, but you know, that's the popular movie with Will Ferrell.
Oh, beautiful, yeah.
That makes sense.
Ooh, now, yeah. I happen to bring my calendar.
Oh yeah.
You happen to see what date
what
yesterday
happened?
Was.
What happened?
That's today when we're filming, but it's that
Groundhog Day.
One of your favorite holidays.
One of my absolute favorite holidays.
Dog
I
calendar.
Love all the lore about it. I love Punxsutawney Phil. He's adorable. Oh, we got a picture of him, I think we do.
Yeah.
And I also love just everything about you. Go down to Gobbler's Knob, my favorite town in America.
I love rodents that predict the weather.
Right.
But we've let him have too much power.
That's
and
probably
we
true.
Now know that he has predicted 6 more weeks of winter. And I know.
We could have guessed that.
Phil,
come on now.
And I was just reminded how Bill de Blasio killed a groundhog a few years ago.
That's actually true.
He really did. He dropped one, and then it fell. It was named Charlotte.
Mm-hmm.
And they tried to cover it up.
Yeah, they tried to pretend like, oh, she was already sick from other things.
No, that man's too tall, and he dropped it from a very tall height.
That's a small animal.
Tiny animal.
Yeah, no, absolutely not. Bill, get shorter. Well, all right, yeah, let's get on with it then.
Okay, yeah, we've got a lot of news to talk about. I'm happy to be here having a snow day.
Yeah, that is nice.
Show with you guys. We got a new plant,
if you
can see this.
It's a beautiful set dressing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's time to get right into it with our first segment. You know it. You love it. It's
Hot Topics.
Yeah, that's right.
So this is Hot Topics. These are the unavoidable news stories that we talk about every week, the big headlines.
Yep, so we'll get right into it. There's just no way to get around it. The story that rightfully dominated headlines this week was all about GameStop, baby.
Bye-bye.
That's right. It was 2006 at the mall all over again, and the video game retailer was back on top of the world. I personally found myself asking, how the hell did this happen? People aren't buying hard copies of video games anymore, and COVID destroyed in-person retailers, so what gives?
Well, gather around, kids, and let's talk about the invisible hand of the market, which this week is actually incredibly visible. That's right, the sudden resurgence of the fading company was all due to the stock market manipulation. A quick lesson, if you haven't already read up on this, let's talk about short selling. Or a lot of men have explained this to me.
It was a fabulous week for that.
It's a practice where very rich people who make all their money on speculation borrow a stock for a time, betting that it will lose value and then pocket the difference when it does.
Yeah, no, that seems like totally good and right. And the thing
when rich
happen.
People do it, they're fine with it.
Yeah, so enter the DJ. At longstanding subreddit Wall Street Bets. So basically, they saw what these hedge funds were doing, short selling GameStop stock, which was a sentimental one for them,
mm-hmm.
and a ton of posters there decided to rally together, purchase and hold GameStop stock, raising its value so high that anyone who had invested with the intention of making a quick buck as it declined was now left in massive debt. Beautiful. Melvin Capital, the main focus of the short squeeze, immediately declared bankruptcy and was bailed out, shocking, to the tune of $2.8 billion $1 million by investors Steve Cohen and Ken Griffin.
Doesn't that guy own the Mets?
He sure does.
The day trading app RobinHood, which I actually used to use, in a brutal twist of irony, went immediately to protecting the wealthy, but not to continue to allow people to buy GameStop. They stopped their ability to, as well as other companies with outdated business models like AMC, Bed Bath & Beyond, and BlackBerry.
That sucks. You know, I thought BlackBerry was coming back, and I thought I was finally on it.
Oh, I missed my BlackBerry.
So, I don't know. What's the takeaway after all of this chicanery? I mean, guys, it's that money's just as not real as it ever was. I don't know, guys. It's a rigged up system. It's meant to keep people exactly where they are. And as we saw, the full machinery of the capitalist state comes down to crush people who attempt at mobility. We're not going to day trade our way to a fair and just society, no matter how cool the branding is. So I say, tear it down, baby.
Yeah. Sorry, you guys just showed your ass how this whole system is pretty wonky. I mean, it's all gambling.
It's literally all gambling, which, like, I want to be cool, and I wish, you know, they could just, you know, figure that out. Yeah, speaking of gambling.
I thought we would do a fun little thing here, and we got some scratchers.
Yeah, this is our version of the stock market, baby.
Yeah, well, I wish I could go to a casino. We love a casino.
Yeah, it's not good, though,
so
right now.
I got scratchers. Casey, this one's for you, too.
Shit.
Take whichever one you want. Scratchies.
51 or 53.
We're going to see. I am historically pretty good at scratchers.
Right.
Can I do this with the bottom of my beer?
Probably take the thing on. I'm going to use this pen.
Jesus Christ.
It's okay. All right. So, yeah, in case you missed it, there was a man in Idaho this week who for the sixth time hit a jackpot on scratchers. So he's won the lotto 6 times in Idaho.
This is trash.
Not a winner?
Not a winner.
I don't have a fucking winner either.
Casey?
Yeah, I got 2 sevens.
Come on, get us with the third seven. Yeah, for this
row.
One, you need to win. You get 3 sevens in a row. That's why it's called lucky sevens. Anything?
One time I won.
No, are eights valuable?
No. It has to be 3 sevens in a row.
3 sevens in a row. I got a loser too.
Okay, me too.
I won $1,000 on a scratch.
You know, that's my 401k. Busted.
Busted. Sorry, State of New York Lottery.
Yeah, what a shock.
Okay.
Yeah, but I mean, that's kind of the big thing.
That's the big thing going on in the news.
I was talked to death, and we're not going to go any further.
Yeah,
I'll leave that to the professionals.
I tried professionals. Some trading stocks on Robinhood at one time, but I don't have them anymore because I'm broke.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not.
My only takeaway from it was if you have a lot of money, it's easy to make a lot of money.
My plan is to die penniless.
Cool.
Yeah, I think that's my retirement.
I'll take care of all of your medical costs after
you
pass.
Thank you, yeah. I think the show's gonna pay for it,
I'll put it on the tall boy's credit
card. Put it on the credit card, the Cicely.
All right, well, I think it's time for our next segment.
Yeah, we can get into our next segment. We love to do this one.
Oh, we've got a lot to talk about today.
Absolute banger.
It's pop culture, this is...
Entertainment!
Oh, yes.
And welcome
to Entertainment!
That's right. It's everybody's favorite segment. We're running down.
I slipped on some glasses.
Pop culture, fucking TV, what to watch.
Movies.
Anything. Music.
Andy Kenyon's movie minute.
The big stuff. We're going to bring us Andy Kenyon thing back. Nobody seems to know him.
Yes.
Casey doesn't know him. You know,
from
the back of
the
cab.
And,
you know,
he reviews movies.
I guess nobody's taking cabs anymore. Either way.
First, we're losing a lot of legends lately, but
yes.
This is Cicely Tyson.
Yeah, we would not be...
R.I.P.
Couldn't go without saying it. A 7-decade career in Broadway, on Hollywood.
95?
An absolute legend. Was playing, you know, portraying like real black women on stage and screen before.
I think she was the first black woman to host SNL.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
But yes, huge career.
Yeah.
R.I.P.
I saw Hal Holbrook just died. Dustin Diamond died.
Very young.
A bunch.
Oh, yeah.
44.
Okay, what else
nicer
we have here?
News.
sure.
Ella Emhoff, Kamala Harris's stepdaughter, just signed with IMG Models.
Right.
She's a little indie darling of the fashion world right now.
I mean, I'm not going to go so far as that. She's a rich kid. She's a rich kid is what's going on here.
I'm saying I'm seeing people.
It's a weird discourse. There's a lot of like weird like homophobia and like...
She gay?
She's non-binary.
No, nice.
I do know that. And so it gets a little weird where I'm just like, please make fun of her for being a rich person benefiting from nepotism. That's good. That's punching up.
Amanda
please
Gorman.
Please do not be.
Amanda Gorman also got a modeling contract with IMG. And she will be doing a, from the inauguration, you remember. And she will be doing a poem at the Super Bowl because there's no rules about it.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Same with her inauguration speech. They're a little bit like using this very intelligent young girl to push a unity message that, like, okay, but
like
she's amazing. I'm excited to see what her whole career holds. She's literally 22. A lot to work with there.
I want to talk about Dolly Parton. I feel uncomfortable standing any celebrity too hard, where I know they can break my heart, but she's never really led me wrong. And apparently she turned down the Presidential Medal of Freedom twice from Trump. And she was just like, I couldn't make the schedule work, but she knew why.
She's actually pretty famously good at being like, no politics, but like, no like performative one. She's like, no, I donate, I have this foundation, I do way more.
She doesn't like when campaigns use her songs like anybody.
Because you know everybody wants to use 9 to 5.
Everybody, well, Elizabeth Warren tried to make it her campaign song and Dolly was like, sorry.
Well, you know what Dolly is doing? Speaking of Amanda Gorman at the Super Bowl, Dolly's also doing a fucking commercial at the Super Bowl.
Yeah, and it's called, it's 5 to 9.
5 to 9, it's
about
who?
It's for like Squarespace or whatever it is, it's a I make a website commercial.
They're gonna, what,
and
which means 5 to 9?
5 to 9, it's about working on your website from 5 o'clock till 9 p.m.
Like after your regular job?
Yes, after you get off of work, they're like looking at a clock like, ooh, when does it turn to 5?
God, so the I gig economy. Wow, this sucks. That sucks so bad.
Dolly didn't need that money.
I hope they give her $9 million and she contributes it to fucking a great charity.
Oh my gosh. Okay, and that, talking about Drag Race.
Oh, we always got to talk about Drag Race.
Drag Race.
Thanks.
Start your engines. We had a ball. We had the bag
ball. Oh my God, we had the bag ball.
Utica with the sleeping.
If you don't watch the show, the ball is kind of like maybe the best episode every season. Debatable.
Yeah. It's just they do 36 runway looks.
Each girl does a ton of runway looks. Some of them are handmade, and there were some incredible looks this week.
I liked Gottmik.
One, I know I have a picture of it. This is Utica. Utica Queen, that's her. This is her sleeping bag look. So she made this handmade garment.
It's a stun.
It's incredible. It's very, she's from Minnesota too. So it's very northern, very like big hooded, like kind of, what'd you say, like druidic, but like make it a sleeping bag. It's incredible.
And John, we were right. Joey J is gone.
Joey J got cut last week. Keep coming to us. We are the Punxsutawney Phil of the show.
Who's gone next week?
Who is gone next week? Who's looking kind of?
It's a disco. Lala was looking pretty rough at the end of last week.
It's a disco dance challenge.
Got to be good for Nolly. Got to be good for Elliot.
I'll say I'm worried about Tamisha because she has already said like I'm recovering from cancer, and I am older. And like, this is, I do not move like the other girls move. Simply don't. I'm 30 years older than some of these girls. And I hope she doesn't go home because she's one of my favorites.
Candy Muse, don't pick fights with Tamisha.
With the legend, please stop.
Absolutely not.
You look ugly. I don't like it.
All right, and now, finally for entertainment, we have one surprise.
Huge.
The Lady Gaga Chromatica Oreos.
If you know, last year, Lady Gaga put out her album, Chromatica.
I do know.
It was amazing. I remember it was a very special memory, actually, from last year. The night it came out at midnight, and we were listening to the album while we were also watching footage on our phones of the police precinct in Minneapolis lighting up on fire.
Oh, right.
And fireworks shooting from the air. It was an incredible moment.
That's, Chromatica into 911.
Into the third precinct burning.
So anyways, we have these Oreos now. They are pink and green Oreos. And thank you to the elite gays on my Twitter. Mm-hmm. I have some in my possession.
We got some. We have
Patrick
some here on
Keen,
the show. Patrick
Keen, specifically.
Thanks, Pat. Is it Pat? I don't know.
Yeah,
Pat. Okay, good. Yeah. Okay.
Patrick Keen, thank you so much for hooking me up with these Oreos. Casey, bring on the Oreos.
Casey, can you bring us these Chromatica Oreos?
It's a huge day for Casey to come on to the show.
Yeah, this is a big Casey day.
Okay.
Thanks, Casey. So, you want one, too?
I've already had some.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Okay, I've had a few, too, yeah.
Here we go.
Grip them.
Here you go, Casey. They've got her little symbol on them. Mm-hmm. And as I was just explaining to John, they're not just regular Oreos.
No, it's not
There's
a chocolate
something going
Oreo.
On here. And it's citrusy or I kind of think it's like watermelon-y.
I'm just getting like a vanilla, like a blonde Oreo vibe, and maybe there's a hint of something else for sure.
It just tastes like store frosting and like cereal milk.
Mm-hmm. But it could be that thing where like you see the color and so it makes you think it's more flavor, like Tricks, mm-hmm. the cereal. Like I don't believe they actually have different flavors. I think they're all one flavor.
I mean, the colors for these are so garish. Like mm-hmm. they're so turned mm-hmm. up.
If I mean, these they match
were pastels,
the album.
I would love this. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's really deep green.
Mm-hmm. These are beautiful. Mm.
They're so good. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Patrick Keane. Thank you, Lady Gaga. And thank you for all the people at Oreos.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you so much.
Please send us some more.
Yeah, we'll take more if you got the hookup. We also, is the curry real? If the curry, the lady, I saw the Chromatica
curry. I'm sure you can make Chromatica curry.
If it's real, I want that too.
What would your flavor of Oreo be, John?
What my flavor of Oreo be?
Yeah.
I mean, they already have like peanut butter chocolate ones. That's all I care about. Mm.
I would do Earl Grey.
Oh. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh. Mary Van Leeuwen style. Mm-hmm. But anyway, oh.
Thank you, Gaga.
Oh my God.
Whoa.
Oh my God, oh my wait God. A second.
Hold on, guys.
Stop. Oh owl. My God, there is a huge snowy
it
owl
is
right
a
here.
Huge snowy owl.
Oh my God, this is incredible.
Look at this right here. This is just like the one that was in Central Park earlier
this
week.
What a visit we're getting. Yeah,
and this is apparently the first time they'd had a sighting. Like well, 140 I mean, years.
And you know they're down here because they're following the snow. It's been real blustery lately.
This is as low as they go, but when the snow is like this, they feel very comfortable.
Oh my God, gorgeous. I wonder if he's hunting a mouse or...
Yeah. Oh, I saw a picture of one that had a bloody face the other day. It was
right,
so
like it like just ripped the...
White birds with some flecks, but they have striking yellow eyes. Mm,
you can
These
always
are
tell, yeah, they're beautiful.
Beautiful birds. Mm, God. And they're huge.
What a gorgeous
They're
baby.
Really, really big. And they're what a treat. Mm. Everybody... Oh, you know, it's like Harry Potter's.
Mark bird. It off your cards, though, folks. Mark it off
Everybody
your cards.
Everybody mark.
God, I can't believe it. Four weeks, four birds.
Owl.
4 weeks, four birds. That's incredible luck.
Snowy.
Got it.
Owl.
Oh, there it goes.
Bye.
Oh, my God. There it goes. All right. Bye. That was beautiful.
Bye. That was a special one.
That was such a special moment.
While I was having my Chromatica Oreos. Mm-hmm.
And it's time for another special moment. Mm. If you will, come with us on a journey. My co-host, Devin Ritchie. Takes you into a very special segment. It's only happening this week. It's Britney Botch.
Hi, and welcome to my new segment, It's Britney Botch. This week there is a new documentary coming out about Britney Spears, and it's produced by the New York Times, and it's gonna air on FX and Hulu. Check out this little preview.
Especially for somebody capable of so much that I know firsthand she's capable of.
Why is she still in this? Why is her dad making all of her decisions?
What do we want? Free Britney!
Yeah, Framing Britney Spears. This looks like it's gonna be really good, and if this person looks familiar, she should. This person is Felicia Collado. Felicia is Britney's former assistant and best friend, and even played the teacher in the Baby One More Time video, see? And you know Faye has all the tea and has never said anything before, and she's in this documentary. You might have heard about the Free Britney movement on Twitter, but it's not just a hashtag and a meme. The bare bones of this are basically, in February 1st, 2008, a judge granted Britney's dad a 4-day temporary conservatorship that is still on 13 years later to this day. Now, my general policy with Britney stuff is to leave her alone. We've learned our lesson. We were absolute freaks to her for years, and if she wants no attention, let her live in peace, and for God's sakes, unless she needs our help by bringing attention to her case, and it seems like maybe she does. She has petitioned the court to get this removed unsuccessfully several times and tried to get the details of her case to go public. Britney's dad, Jamie, has called the Free Britney movement a hoax, an internet hoax, and a joke, but Britney has said that she appreciates the concern. Look. Basically, we don't know all the details about this case, but something feels absolutely shady about her family not letting her out of this and making sure the cash cow keeps the cash flowing. It's bad. I'm ready to get some more information on this, but no matter what, if this is unacceptable, that this woman isn't able to make her own decisions for herself or her children or her career. And the fact that this remains, you know, this would never have happened to a male celebrity. Imagine this happening to Justin Bieber or Kanye, putting their dad in charge. No, it would never have happened. And she never even got arrested or anything crazy like that. What was the big deal? Young woman shaves her head? Oh, Jesus, call the mental hospital. Got a live one here. And I'm weary that the solution is more media attention, but it seems like we might be approaching an inflection point where hopefully Britney Jean can make all of her own decisions and focus on what really is important, her incredible Instagram presence.
It's not true. Tell me I've been lying.
So, good luck, Brit. And now, here's something a little different.
It's been 4 days since anyone's seen Devin. I told him not to leave during a storm like this, but he simply wouldn't hear of it. "It's just a trip to the bodega," he said. "What's the worst that can happen?" he said. Now I do not know where he is. Taken by wolves? A yeti? Mysteriously wiped away in a suspicious avalanche, like the 9 Russian hikers in the Dyatlov Pass incident of 1959? Wherever he is, I do hope he ended up getting that Gatorade.
Dearest John, as I'm sure you have noticed that I have not turned from my great journey to the bodega. No, Mother Nature had a different plan for me. I became overwhelmed at the snow and decided to make a base camp, but provisions are running out. My morale is plummeting as my chance for survival is fading. I fear one of my companions has the madness in his eyes, and I may have to eat him before he eats me. Love, Devin.
Dearest Devin, I would have to emphasize that cannibalism should not even be your last resort. And I think that guy you're talking about is you? P.S. How did I get this letter?
Dearest John, this will be my final correspondence, as I am letting the elements take over my body. I am giving myself to the snow. We never did get to watch Frozen 2. I'm going to live my life like Ella and go into the unknown, but the Panic at the Disco version.
Wait. Dude.
Huh? What?
Oh my god, wait, what are you doing?
What?
I got lost. In this?
It happened again.
Did you get my seltzer? Fuck.
I'll go back and get it. And now, it's time for everyone's favorite segment. This is John's Sports Corner.
Oh, that's right. Folks, we got ourselves a Super Bowl this Sunday. That's right, it's back to John's Sports Corner. This week, Tom Brady and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers are set to face off against reigning champion Patrick Mahomes and the Kansas City Chiefs for the title. And while the game may be fun and all, what we're really interested in is the halftime show. That's right. Few things have the annual potential to give us iconic moments in pop music history like the Super Bowl halftime show. This year's featured star is The Weeknd, who you've no doubt seen appear more and more beaten to a pulp throughout the last year as part of some undefined bit that inevitably resulted in this. Now, suffice to say, I've heard the song Blinding Lights 9 trillion times, and I can't believe they just said, like, what if we make an exact song from the 80s? And it worked! Yeah, they did it. I'm ready to see what he's got planned, and I hope to be blown away. For my taste, he doesn't quite have the stature or the hits as some of the best performers of the past, but he's a huge draw nonetheless, and I know the NFL, and they will definitely be spectacle. Now, in preparation for his performance, I'd thought we'd take a little trip down memory lane and talk about some of the hits, flops, and all-time moments of halftime shows past. So before it became the star-studded event that you know it as today, The halftime show was really just for, like, the fans in attendance and was generally played by big marching bands with, you know, overblown themes that sounded like the worst homecoming dance ideas. Some examples include Happiness Is and 200 Years and Just a Baby for our bicentennial, and my personal favorite, Something Grand, where 88 grand pianos were rolled out onto the field to play the music of Chubby Checker. All that changed in 1991. So Disney took over production that year, and they added Coca-Cola as like a mega sponsor, and they said, what if we get New Kids on the Block, who were huge with the teens at the time? And this kind of like started the snowball of changing the show. And so then 2 years later, Michael Jackson took the reins and performed a 5-song medley, which has remained one of the most watched television performances in American history. This sparked like a massive increase in ratings, and the NFL never looked back. So some performances stick out more than others. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the infamous nip slip in 2004. One of Janet Jackson's nipples was exposed during a dance move with Justin Timberlake, which sent repressed Americans everywhere into a fervor, resulting in 5 years of forgettable dad rock halftimes. Now, Janet's career legitimately suffered for this, and Justin never really stood up for her, which we have not forgot, Justin. We have not. Now, we also got Beyonce twice. What a gift. Although, the second time they made her share the stage with the Coldplay guy, what a slap in the face. Lady Gaga stunned us in 2017 when she leapt from the top of the stadium, I think it was in Houston, to enter the field. And now there's like the last few years have had these sort of odd attempts to please everybody, and they've led to these really hilarious pairings like Bruno Mars and the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Maroon 5 and Travis Scott, as well as Katy Perry and Missy Elliott, the year that gave us the infamous left shark. You know it. Now, the all-time most iconic Super Bowl halftime performance, however, is none other than Prince himself, Minnesota baby. The late genius pulled off an absolutely spine-tingling Goosebumps-level performance in 2007 as he sang and played Purple Rain in a literal torrential downpour in Tampa and never missed a beat. If you haven't watched it, we're not going to put the video here so the NFL doesn't take it down, but you absolutely have to. It's incredible. Prince, we miss you dearly, and I hope your reincarnated spirit is like out there like as a deer or some person already ready to get going on this stuff. Well, this has been John Sports Corner. Here's Shakira playing drums last year at the Super Bowl. And on a side note, basketball related, Sacramento Kings, baby. De'Aaron Fox, an all-star this year. Make him it. I will campaign. I will not stop on this. 38-12 last night. Killed the Pelicans. Anyway, enjoy the halftime show. We'll see you next week. Take care.
Oh, I am excited for the Super Bowl.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a fun show, no matter what.
The weekend.
The weekend. Yeah, the weekend. Yeah. I don't know if he's going to top last year, but we'll see.
I like that song. No, I don't know that one.
You know the one. It's everywhere right now. They just say, oh, I do. You know the one. I'm talking about. Touch. Yeah, I don't know what he's, yeah. I don't know what he's doing.
you know, it's maybe a bigger stage for him than...
Exactly.
Maybe, you know, there's going to be some fun guests or something.
Who knows?
Who do you think is going to win the Super Bowl?
I think the Chiefs are going to win the Super Bowl.
The Kansas City Chiefs?
Yeah, I think so. I think Patrick Mahomes is too good.
And I think the Thomas Buccaneers are going to win.
The Thomas Brady Buccaneers. That's Devin's call.
Do you want to put money on it?
No.
And we'll see next week.
No, we don't have any money. We just went over this. We don't have any money. We lost on those scratchers.
Yeah. Well, I really loved last year's Super Bowl with Shakira and J-Lo. And it was just her birthday.
Nothing is better with a Super Bowl than a nice beer,
I say.
A beer
holiday, even.
It is actually a beer holiday. And what are we drinking this week?
Today we are drinking the Stranger Than Chocolate and Coconut Porter. From Collective Arts Brewing.
And it is a wintry, perfect day.
It's coconutty porter. Mm.
The coconut does really come through. It's really toasted.
If you're not familiar with porters, they're really dark. And I like to drink them in the winter. Mm-hmm. They are.
This, I would say, what would you like to be doing drinking this beer? What are you thinking?
Lying naked on a bearskin rug in a cabin with a lover.
This is like, for me, I'm having like a winter holiday party, but it's tropical themed. Like I'm in a cold place, but we're doing like like, fucking, you know, like, pretend like we're on the beach theme, and then the coconut's coming through, but it's...
The coconut is coming through. Chocolatey, nutty, it's bright.
Sick art on this thing. This is like this, like vicious, like, I don't know, it's like a crazy, like, devil dog looking thing. It's
cascade
awesome.
Cascade and nugget hops. But it's kind of warming me up on a cold, wintry day.
Yeah, so thanks, Collective Arts.
Thank you, Collective Arts. And next, we're getting to one of our favorite segments. This is our plug of the week, where we show you guys something that our friends are working on or have made. This week, we have a special one. This is my friend, Angel Yao. Mm. And she makes stop motion.
This is a really cool stop motion vid, yeah.
And yeah, she makes beautiful stop motions that are very, like, from her perspective and just kind of, like, kind of whispers her poetry over them, and they're really beautiful.
Love it.
And so check this out. This is Curtain Call by Angel Yao.
My mom decided to enroll me in dance class because my teacher said I was extremely shy. One time my leotard was still in the laundry and my mom gave me my swimsuit to wear instead without leggings. The girls gave me a wedgie and floaties and a surfboard. Just kidding. They just gave me a wedgie. My mom also enrolled me in piano class because my fingers were long. I wanted to quit, but I was too scared. Till this day, I only really know how to play one of the parts to Heart and Soul. The dun 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 part. I was finally given a part in the school play, Oklahoma. It was a made-up part because the teacher felt bad for me. She said, "Your character's name will be Vivian Lee. You know, the Gone with the Wind actress? But instead of L-E-I-G-H, it'll be spelled L-E-E, because, you know, you're Asian." Here is a snippet of a song I wrote in junior high school. A freak by the window is a freak not for sale. A freak by the window is a human too. I was at my mom's work holiday karaoke party. I was waiting my turn to sing Crush by Jennifer Page. When her boss finally asked me if I wanted to sing, and before I could even answer, my mom said, "Oh no, no, no. She sings like a dog." Looking back, that doesn't even make sense. The only reason why I ran for my high school election was to use that 5 minutes of speech time to show people that I exist. I wanted to memorize my speech and not read from a piece of paper like everyone else for drama. So during my speech, I ripped up my papers and told them that I was going to speak from my heart. I had a memory problem, so I actually read from tiny index cards instead. I hope no one noticed. I also wrote a song with words that rhymed with my last name, like cow, mow, and wow. I really was hoping for a lot of compliments afterwards, but I only received one comment. Clarissa said, "Man, you got balls." I joked that I was going to do stand-up for a high school talent show, and everyone laughed. And I thought, they laughed. My first set was recording my inner monologue of how nervous I was. After that set, my friends came up to me and said, "Wow, you're really funny." Everyone was not expecting me to do that. It was really the first time I received compliments. I wanted to continue to surprise people. The first time I took my mom to watch my comedy was a Bring Your Show in Times Square. I did my inner monologue bit. The CD player was not working. I bombed. Afterwards, my mom said, "Why didn't you joke about Facebook or iPods or Starbucks like all the men did in the show?" And then she said, "You know, I regret letting you do dance class. I think it gave you too much courage." I grew up being quiet because I hate being misunderstood, which I felt was worse than being quiet, which is why I stayed quiet. But being on stage helped me craft what I wanted to say out loud. And now I can say it from the heart.
I love stuff like
thank
that.
You, Angel. Oh my God, thank you for submitting that.
Thank you so much.
Letting us show it off.
And now we are getting to our favorite time of the day.
Oh, that's right. It's almost the end of the show, so we're doing our Fan submissions.
That's right. And if you want to submission your
your fan, your, yeah,
you can. Casey, can you bring me the laptop?
Yeah, every week we get pet pictures from people. Let's see what we got this. We got some interesting emails.
Say, Casey,
this week.
Say hi to them.
Casey, don't go on and say a thank you. There we go. There
so I will have to say this email had a concerning headline.
I was worried when I opened it.
It said it said licking pussy, and it was a cat licking this pole. And I actually don't know the name of this.
We didn't get a name. We didn't get.
It's from Shay, and it says, "I hope this email finds you well." And it does.
And long tongue, a lot of water there.
Oh, this one's really cute. Let's see, that is Lulu.
Okay, and then
she's an adopted cane terrier and was rescued from Field of Dreams Animal Rescue in California.
Thanks,
Kevin. Lulu loves to play fetch, go on long mountainous hikes, and snuggle. Me too.
Me too.
Okay, and then a couple more. These are all the same cat, and this is Edie, or Eddie, but named after Edith Piaf. She loves to climb counters,
classy.
Sunbathe on wind ceilings, and occasionally yowl from the rooftops.
Okay, we've got some more animals.
She can't figure out how to climb down. Okay, yeah, she's eaten off the counter.
Oh, beautiful classic. Oh. I know all about this. Oh, yeah. It's a story, really.
You aren't stopping her. You are taking pictures.
It was a produced photo shoot, actually. I think that's beautiful. She's living the good life.
Okay.
And then,
Well, there's a bean.
Oh, of course, Bean got in here. What's he doing?
Is it the avocado toast?
What a millennial.
Beautiful.
He's not saving for retirement, though.
Wow. You know, as always, if you want to call in, it's 718-588-0869.
Call in, drop
and
us a line.
And if you want to email your pets, it is tallboyshow@gmail. And we'll feature them and
truly
put them up here.
We love to see them. Send us their name, something about them, personality, you know?
Okay. Well, that about wraps it up,
That
John.
Sure does.
Wow. I'm so glad we had a show this week because a blizzard put us in a precarious spot for a second.
Made it real nasty there.
We almost filmed from the house.
There wasn't much to do. Mm-hmm.
But I hope everybody's staying warm, and thank you for all who's watching right now. Like and subscribe to the channel.
Yes,
tell your
absolutely.
Friends if you like it.
Yeah, this is on our Wicked Ladies YouTube channel, and is a more crucial time than ever to support your venues and stages and bars and restaurants.
So it's getting weird out there, y'all.
Get over to their Instagram, their YouTube.
Buy some merch.
Yeah, buy some merch. Do anything. They've got like an awesome calendar for 2021 still up.
Oh, yeah.
That's got like, you know, the bar babes over here. It's very cool. Support them.
Looking forward to the Super Bowl this weekend.
I am too. Yeah. I'm gonna
feels like it's gonna snow a lot more this week.
I think so too. Yeah, it's gonna get squirrely out there. So stay warm.
Stay
warm. Safe. Drink some beer.
Cheers. Cheers.
Absolutely. And thank you. We'll see you next week.
Yeah, and here's a picture of Pedro Pascal. And
it isn't in the morning. Isn't at night. It's a talk show for the afternoon. Everything's alright. It's a little bit of knowledge and a lot of noise. It's two talk boys.
But yeah, I'm
wearing those. Tall Boys is not filmed in front of a live studio audience. There's no audience.
They're cheap.
They are affordable. That is very nice, though.
Yeah. All right.